You're listening to Bible Truth Feed, a podcast by Christadelphianvideo.org for Christadelphians and all those seeking the truth about the Bible message. Join us now as we present our latest episode.
Why believe in God? And we're going to do that by thinking about two aspects. First of all, the world in which we live, the universe, and where it came from, why it's here. And secondly, human beings, what makes them unique, the human experience, and why that might be the way that it is. And we're going to be looking for the best explanation for those things. Believing in God is not like believing in chairs. We can't see God. We can't touch him in that sense. And yet there is strong evidence. So we can't do an experiment that would prove that God exists experimentally, just as we can't do an experiment to prove that God doesn't exist. But what we've got to do is look at the evidence from the two domains that I've talked about, the world and human experience, and ask ourselves, what is the best explanation for what we see? Is the best explanation that there is a God, a personal God, a supernatural mind behind it all powerful and all wise? Or is the best explanation the atheist's explanation that all this has come about by natural causes in an undirected fashion in that sense? I'd like to start, though, not with the universe, but with something much more mundane. I've got my glass of water here beside me, and I'd like us to just think for a minute about that glass of water. Why is there a glass of water? And we might answer that question by thinking about where the glass of water came from, what it's made from. And, you know, we might start to talk about the properties of hydrogen atoms and oxygen atoms and how they can come together to form water. We might start to talk about glass factories and the chemical constitution, the processes by which glass is made. And that's all very well. We can go back and back, can't we, to the tap, to the water reservoir, to the glass factory, to the raw materials that went into it. We can go back and back and back. But really, that's only one way of answering the question, why is there a glass of water? It's not just about where the constituent parts came from. There's actually a more interesting answer, which is an answer about, who put the glass of water there. It's an answer about agency, not just the what, but the whom, the agency. And, the reason why there's a glass of water, it could be because someone brought it to me and put it there, or because I got it myself because I thought I might have a coughing fit in the middle of giving this talk or whatever the case might be. So the who question, there's that, isn't there? But even that isn't enough. There's a deeper question, which is the why question. And really the why is, well, I've kind of already answered it. It's not just about I put it there or my sister put it there or whatever. It's about why it was done, because I didn't want to have a cough or because I was thirsty. Now, we can ask those questions about a glass of water, but we can ask exactly the same questions about the universe, about the world in which we live, about the earth. I think what we wouldn't accept about the glass of water is that it just happened. It spontaneously appeared out of nowhere, out of nothing, for no reason. And if we wouldn't accept that about the glass of water, it's kind of hard to accept it about the universe, isn't it? And why is that? It's because we know that the world works on the basis of cause and effect. If things don't, aren't intrinsically required to be there, if they don't have an explanation of their existence in themselves, if they don't necessarily exist, as a philosopher might say, then they must have an external cause. And in fact, the whole of science proceeds on that basis, doesn't it? That any effect that you see can be traced back to a cause, and we can do that in a logical and systematic way. Systems aren't just randomly constituted, just popping into existence. And, you know, there's not much more complex a system than the entire universe that you could think of, is there, to do that? So if we wouldn't accept that the glass of water just happened or came out of nothing, out of nowhere, for no reason, by no one, then what about the universe? And in fact, this is one of the famous arguments for the existence of God. And it's, you know, it goes by the rather mouthful of a name, the cosmological argument. But what it basically says is that everything that begins to exist has a cause. And if that weren't the case, you couldn't do science, could you? You know, if you couldn't reason from effects to causes, then in a systematic way, then science would be impossible. So everything that begins to exist has a cause. The universe began to exist, therefore the universe has a cause. So it's entirely logical, isn't it? It follows. So you can't have a universe out of nothing, or can you? Well, some have tried to argue that you can, but I think when people try to do that, and of course scientists, there's a certain branch of philosophical science that does that, and in terms of explaining the Big Bang, I think what happens in some way in those attempts is that what we're doing, we find ourselves in an attempt to redefine what nothing means. That, oh, well, actually, it's not nothing, there's something. But what all you do there is you push the problem one stage further back, don't you? Because you say, well, there's the universe, and there were some preconditions, in a way, like a preverse, you know, a preverse before the universe. But you haven't really answered the question of why the universe then, or what caused the universe, because you've said, oh, well, there's this preverse, these preconditions, and what caused the preverse? What caused those conditions? And you can be locked into this infinite regress of going back and back looking for causes, but never finding the beginning. And you know, this has been called the issue of, you know, turtles all the way down. Like, what's the earth stood on? Oh, on the back of a turtle. What's that turtle stood on? Oh, the back of another turtle. And you just go on and on with turtles to infinity. Well, of course, it makes no sense. And it doesn't make sense with the universe either. Some have suggested that the universe must necessarily have come into existence because there was some force or law that required it. But again, you would have to ask the question of why was that force? Why did those laws exist? Who was the lawmaker? Because a law of itself doesn't explain something, does it? So there are rules or laws of chess, if you like, and we know what the rules of chess are. You know, the rook moves this way and the bishop moves that way. But the laws of chess don't create the game of chess, do they? You need something outside of chess and outside of its laws in order to create the game of chess. And of course, a mind did that. So Julie Andrews actually put it rather well when she said those famous words in The Sound of Music, nothing comes from nothing, nothing ever could. So it's really very difficult to argue that the universe can just come from nothing, in just as it is to argue that my glass of water did. In fact, it must be materially harder to do that, mustn't it? Now, there might be an objection at this point, and you know, it's a popular one that's raised, that says, well, what about God? What caused God then? And the answer is that God, the very definition of God, is that he is causeless, that he is outside of these rules of nature, of matter, of the material. He is outside time and space. And you notice that the definition of the cosmological argument was everything that begins to exist has a cause. God didn't begin to exist. So, you know, to say what caused God or where did God come from is like saying, how is that circle square? And the answer is, oh, why is the circle square? And it's a meaningless question. It just doesn't make sense as a question. And it doesn't make sense actually to ask the question, where does God come from? Because God is defined as eternal, outside of space and time and matter and causation. He is defined as the prime mover. But, and you know, that might sound like a cop-out, but it's not. That's just the definition. And the question is, do we need something with that definition in order to explain the universe? And the answer is yes. or it seems to be, that's precisely what we need. We need something outside of matter to explain where matter came from. You can't explain matter by matter. You can't explain natural processes by natural processes, or time by time. So we need a being who is outside of space and time and matter, who transcends those things, something who is, or someone or something that is supernatural. And, well, that's starting to sound like God, isn't it? And in fact, when we ask ourselves then, so if we need a cause for the universe, what type of cause would that be? Well, it seems that we need a cause that has the attributes of mind. And why do we say that? Because if you have something which is systematic and intricate and intelligible, then it likely has a designer. So, you know, we know the difference between a rubbish dump and an amazingly designed building like the Taj Mahal or something. And the difference is the amazing building has a designer. You know, we know the difference between good design and a pile of junk. And when we look at the universe, what do we see? We see something of incredible intricacy and beauty, something that is just so, a kind of a Goldilocks universe and a Goldilocks planet Earth, whereby if any of the parameters or constants that govern it were adjusted by the tiniest bit, the whole thing couldn't exist, couldn't operate as it does, would be unstable, would never have come about in the first place. So the world, with all its beauty, whether we look at the micro or the macro level, has the shape of something which is supremely designed, and a design, something which is designed, needs a designer. We can ask ourselves, where did the information and the laws that are in the universe come from? Again, laws come from lawmakers. Information has to be created, doesn't spontaneously create itself. And, you know, if the counter argument to that is, well, you know, we can create computers that can create intelligible information, the answer is, well, yeah, but the point is that the computers only exist in the first place because a mind, because we created them, we designed them, didn't we? And so there is a mind behind those things. And the suggestion is, well, it's exactly the same with the universe. Sometimes people criticize belief in God by saying, well, you believe in the God of the gaps. You know, you take science as far as it goes. And then when there are gaps, you say, oh, well, that's God. But I think really that argument misses the point in a very significant way. The point is that the world in which we live is incredibly intelligible. And again, you know, the whole thing, everything that science has achieved demonstrates that, doesn't it? It can be read. The world can be read in some way. It is intelligible. It is understandable. It is not it is not random. It is principled. It is structured. And things that are intelligible require an intelligence to create them. You know, we know the difference between a gobbledygook and, you know, the works of Shakespeare. So the question is, what intelligence then would have brought this incredibly intelligible, readable universe into existence? Is it good enough to say, oh, well, it just happened. We were just incredibly lucky. That's the alternative. I'd like to shift now then into the second part, where we have a think about human beings. And in a way, we're the biggest miracle of all in terms of what there is to be observed within the universe. And I suppose it feels a little bit egotistical, doesn't it, to think like that. But I think there's a good basis for it. So, you know, there are more connections between the neurons in a single human brain than there are stars in the galaxy. It's the human mind, really, with all its potential for creativity, for aesthetics, for creating and appreciating beauty, the potential for spirituality, for emotions, for personhood, for consciousness, for relationships. These are the things that make us human and which distinguish us from the animals. And I think there's a lot of time spent saying about how much we're like the animals. And of course, that's an important part of the evolutionary narrative, isn't it? For under that paradigm that, you know, that we're all taught about in school, that evolutionary model, that theory. But really what's interesting about human beings is what we do that is different to the animals. That's what's really interesting, isn't it? You know, it's our lower functions that we have in common with the animals, not our higher ones. So, you know, if we were to compare the literature of humans with the literature of dogs, we would find there's quite a difference. Well, in fact, there isn't a literature of dogs, of course, is there? The very notion is a foolish one. So the question is that just a lucky accident that we have all these incredible abilities that, you know, that come from our minds, and that we should just reduce them to, you know, electrical impulses in the brain and to you know, to make our minds just be brains that, you know, just got lucky in this evolutionary story? Is it just an accident in that sense? Or are our minds and these incredible abilities we have, are they a reflection of our maker, of the super mind, the supernatural mind that created us all? Because that's what the Bible says, isn't it? That's the narrative in the Bible, that it is no accident that we can do all those amazing things, that we do them, we can do them because we are in some measure in the image of God. And I want to move on from that then to consider some particular aspects of you know, human experience. And one is this longing for something beyond ourselves, for the transcendent. Or we might say that the seeming need of human beings for religion. And, you know, transcendence is, that longing for transcendence is part of that. So, you know, although the atheist or agnostic narrative is a very strong one in parts of the Western world. In fact, you know, if we look across global populations, there are about 2 billion Christians, 1 billion Muslims, 1 billion Hindus, and other religions. The vast majority of people are religious, in fact. Now, and you know, this isn't a talk about the right, you know, who's right and all that, or really it's about whether the atheists are right or whether the religious sense of something more than ourselves and of purely matter and nature, that's our subject. So we need to stick to that. But it's very clear, looking at that population breakdown, that this is a very real aspect of what it means to be human, this longing for something beyond what is purely matter, what is purely tangible, and what is purely subject to natural processes. There is this longing for eternity. Materialism fails ultimately to satisfy the deepest human needs. And incidentally, belief in God not only explains why we should have that longing for something beyond ourselves, it also actually explains the bad stuff about human beings, because that's really important too. You know, we need an explanation for that. Well, of course, the Bible in its portrayal of God and the relationship between God and man has exactly that explanation, and it's a very powerful one. Let me say a few things about morality, because again, it's easier to explain human beings' moral sense under a framework that recognizes the existence of God than I think under an atheistic framework. So although it has often happened in history, we have this sense as human beings, don't we, that it's wrong to trample, you know, it's wrong for the strong to trample on the rights of the weak. And yet lions do it to antelopes all the time, don't they? So lions don't seem to have that sense, and yet we do. Why do we have that sense? Why do we take the view that human beings have you know, dignity and worth. If all we are essentially is matter, if all we are is sacks of chemicals, potentially without even free will, you know, just marching to the drumbeat of our DNA, then there is no basis for saying that human beings have intrinsic value and that it's wrong for the strong not to trample on the weak. There's no, you know, that's just nature that the strong trample on the weak. There is no explanation of why we have that moral sense. But as soon as we bring God into the picture, well, the Bible says that human beings are made in the image of God. So that's why human life has value. That's why we should treat one another with respect. There is a basis now, there is a grounding for morality that there isn't without that belief in God. We need to ground morality beyond human subjectivity and, you know, what feels right for me, because that may very well be something different to what feels right for you. So believing in God, or rather the premise that God exists, allows us to explain this human sense of right and wrong, even if we don't agree about what exactly is right and wrong. We all have that sense of it, and it's that's the point. This sense of there must be a purpose, there must be a meaning. You know, a giraffe doesn't ask why, does it? Doesn't ask where it came from, where it's going to, how it can be a better giraffe than it has been in the past. It doesn't have this longing to transcend. And interestingly, also, the premise of God helps us explain not just purpose and morality, but it also explains, it sort of underpins logic and reason. You see, again, if all we have is the evolutionary narrative, that it's all about survival, the survival of the fittest, how do we know that we can actually trust human reasoning and logic, and that it isn't just something that we're telling ourselves because that was the best mechanism for survival? Well, when we have the premise of God, we can say, actually, we can, in a measure, trust our logic and reasoning insofar as those abilities are a marred reflection of the God who made us. I'd like us to think for a minute about four things that are really important to human beings. And one of them is a sense of identity. Who am I? One is a sense of value. Do I matter? Another is a sense of purpose. Why am I here? And another is agency. Can I make a difference? Now, if you believe in God or under the premise of God, there is a compelling answer to all of those things. Identity. Who am I? Well, you are made in the image of God, and you have a responsibility to him, but you have free will to make your choices about how you're going to live your life. That's pretty, you know, that's a lot of responsibility, but that's pretty exciting, isn't it? What about value? Do I matter? Yes, you do, because you're made in the image of God. Purpose? Why are you here? Well, that is going to relate to why God made human beings in the beginning. And what purpose he has for human beings and for the world that he's made. But you know, the Bible is very clear that it's all about purpose and plan, God's plan. And finally, agency. Can I make a difference? Yes, you can. The choices that you make, how you choose to respond to God, how you choose to treat other people, really makes a difference both now, and it will make a difference in the future. So that's how those four things of identity, value, purpose, and agency look with under the premise of God. What about if we take the atheist paradigm that the universe came about by chance, and then there are just these natural processes of natural selection and so forth, of mutation and natural selection. Identity, who am I? Well, we are fundamentally, slightly more evolved version of the animals. We are, in some ways, just a machine, an algorithm. We are a sack of chemicals, a sack of genes marching to that drumbeat. What about value? Do I matter? Well, we kind of answered that in the first point. If that's all we are, if we, and potentially, and I know, not, you know, some believe this, some don't, that, you know, it, to the extent that that we are predetermined by our genes, we have, you know, we just have those, you know, and if the key thing about us is that, you know, human DNA is not very different to mouse DNA or whatever, then it's hard really to see so much value there, isn't it? What about purpose? Why am I here? Well, because of a lucky accident, effectively, there is nothing that we are called or meant to be. And that then has the possibility of leading to a kind of nihilistic lifestyle, doesn't it? And a sense of despair, potentially existential despair. And then agency. Can I make a difference? Well, again, if all we are is lumbering biological robots, then the answer would be not very much, I suppose. So if atheism is true, then everything has come about as a consequence of chance. There is no real meaning. There is nothing beyond stuff and matter and natural processes. And it all ultimately ends in death, in our death, our friend's death, our family's death, and ultimately the death of all things when the sun runs out of energy. It's pretty, you know, it's not inspiring, is it, that narrative? Well, I'd like to draw things to a conclusion, and I'd like to do that by kind of turning the argument on its head, really, and I'd like us now for a minute to assume that the God of the Bible exists, and say, well, what kind of a world would we expect if that were the case? So the Bible describes a God who is this supernatural, all-powerful, all-wise, eternal God, just yet merciful, infinitely creative and artistic, all-powerful, moral, supremely loving, who wants worship, but also a relationship with us. But he's not going to force that on us. He gives us the free will to choose. A God who seeks harmony and reconciliation with us when we do things which are wrong. Well, if such a God, that's exactly the God who's described to us in the Bible, if such a God exists, then we would expect to find a world very much like the world that we live in. It matches, it fits, a world with consistency and laws and patterns, a world that is interpretable, a world of incredible beauty, a vast and complex world, but one which is finely tuned and suited for life, a world which provides a well-equipped home for the animals, but also especially for the human beings that God has created. And those human beings then are free agents with tremendous capacities. That's what we'd expect to find if the Bible's view is right, with a sense of morality and responsibility. We'd expect to find human-derived problems because of human nature and choice, and with there being this conundrum at the core of every human being, you know, this desire for good, and yet this pulling towards things which are selfish and are not always the best things to do. The ability for those beings to seek a better way, to make a higher choice, beings who are not truly or fully satisfied with the purely material, beings who are able to have deeply fulfilling relationships with God, and who have a sense of, you know, there must be a plan, there must be a purpose, a point, a hope for the future. That's what we would expect to find if the God of the Bible is real. And lo and behold, that is exactly what we do find. And I just think that's incredible that, you know, it's like a hand-in-glove sort of match between what the Bible would lead you to expect and the world that we see. What, by contrast, happens if we take the atheist's point of view? If nature, natural processes, are all that there is, if nature and matter are the whole show, and if mutation and natural selection are the only mechanism through which we have come, then then what would we expect? You know, if that's all there is, you know, there's nothing, and then and that's those are all the inputs we have effectively, then what would we expect? A world subject to chance. We'd expect no order, no beauty or scale, no purpose, no morality, no music, art, religion, no humans, no society, no creatures, no life, no planets, no universe, nothing. That's what we'd expect if that's all that there is. Now, it's possible that this great nothing masquerading as a something, I'm talking about our world, the universe and everything in it, is really a nothing, you know, that it's that it came from nowhere, that it's going nowhere, you know, and when the, you know, when the sun burns out and, you know, in our galaxy and so on. That it came from nothing, it's possible, but it's hard to imagine a less convincing explanation. For all this, the claim that we, and this is a point I think was made by Alistair McGrath quite powerfully, the claim that we are utterly alone in a godless, purposeless, directionless universe in which we are doomed to oblivion is a philosophical claim, but it's also really a religious claim. It's a claim that all that conventional religions, as we see them, are wrong, and that instead the world is godless, purposeless, directionless. You know, that has significant philosophical, religious, moral implications. It's a religious view, a religious claim. And yet, as I hope we've seen in the little bit of time we spent together, there is a far more powerful and satisfying answer, a far more powerful and satisfying explanation about where the world came from, about why it is the way it is, and about the amazing abilities that human beings have, and what the human being, what the human experience is like, and that. The answer to that explanation is found in the Bible. It's really powerful, it's really satisfying, and it's really fulfilling. Well, thanks very much for listening, for the time we've shared together. I hope it's been useful, and there'll be all kinds of links and other talks coming up that you find along with this, which we also hope you'll find interesting. Thanks very much.
Thank you for joining us. We hope you found the episode helpful. Don't forget, most of these episodes are also available as videos on our video channel, cdvideo.org. So head over and take a look. If you have any comments or questions or suggestions, please get in touch or leave us a voice message. We love to hear your feedback. You can email us at bt@cdvideo.org. If you enjoyed the episode, then please share it with others. Until next time, may God bless you in your studies and your walk towards God's kingdom. Amen.